Parasystole, an ectopic focus with automaticity in the heart, which is not suppressed by the sinus node. According to locus of parasystole, it can be atrial or AV junctional, but the most common situation is ventricular origin of parasystole. In this video, we will speak only about ventricular parasystole. So, ventricular parasystole represents an independent ectopic ventricular focus that is not inhibited by the sinus node. As a result, we see two independent rhythms, normal rhythm and parasystolic rhythm. For explaining ventricular parasystole, firstly, let's remain how normally conduction system work. Regular heartbeat occurs when the sinus node conduct an electrical signal down to the atrioventricular node. Further, this electrical signal goes down to the bundle of His and Purkinje fibers in the ventricles. The result is a contraction of the ventricles and pumping of blood from the heart to the arteries. Normally, rhythmic contraction of entire heart is initiated and maintained by the single pacemaker, the sinus node. Therefore, it is primary pacemaker. In addition, there are other special regions throughout the heart, where myocardial cells have the normal, intrinsic ability to initiate impulses by automaticity. They include multiple sites in the right and left atria, atrioventricular junction, and the specialized conducting system of the ventricles. The cells are called latent or subsidiary pacemakers. Sinus node dominates all other potential pacemakers. By its relatively faster rate and overdry suppression. If you want to know more details about mechanism of subsidiary pacemaker suppression, let me know in comments. But the feature of parasystoles is that they have a protection from the sinus node inhibition, that called entrance block. It means that impulse from the sinus node can't reach the parasystole focus because of obstacle. So, sinus node can't inhibit ectopic activity of parasystole as other subsidiary pacemakers. As a result, parasystolic activation of ventricle lead to premature ventricular contraction with regular, slower than sinus node rate. In this case, on ECG, we see monomorphic premature ventricular contractions. But how can we distinguish ordinary premature ventricular contraction and ventricular parasystole? Firstly, we need to measure coupling interval. Coupling interval is the distance from the normal QRS to QRS of premature contraction. In ordinary premature ventricular contraction is 568 milliseconds and 552 milliseconds correspondingly. The difference is very small, so in case of ordinary premature ventricular contraction, coupling interval is fixed. It is constant because the most common mechanism of premature ventricular contraction are reentry and triggered activity. All of these mechanisms are related to previous normal contraction, so it makes coupling interval stable. In case of ventricular parasystole, the coupling interval are 688 milliseconds and 468. So, difference is more than 100 milliseconds. In ventricular parasystole, the mechanism is exceeded automaticity, which is independent from the sinus rate. So, in this case, coupling intervals are different, and the difference should be more than 100 milliseconds, as in our example. So, the first criteria of ventricular parasystole is varying coupling interval, that is more than 100 milliseconds. The automaticity means regularity of parasystolic activation. However, sometimes when next parasystolic activation should be done, ventricles can't be stimulated because of refractory period due to previous normal activation. This inability of parasystole to activate ventricles due to refractory period called exit block. So in some cases due to exit block, parasystolic ventricle activation is failed. The important point is regularity of parasystole. It means parasystole has its own regular rate. That is usually slower than sinus rate. For calculation of parasystolic rate, we need to find the shortest distance between parasystolic contractions. In our case is 1.1 seconds, and use the classic heart rate calculation formula. Therefore, parasystolic rate is 54 beats per minute. So, due to regularity of parasystolic contractions, even if it not be conducted because of exit block, distances between parasystolic contraction, no matter it was succeed or failed, are stable. As a result, large distance between parasystoles consists of sum of shortest distance. In our example, large distance is equal to two shortest distances. And we understand that one parasystolic activation was failed. So, large distance can be divided entirely by the shortest distance between parasystole. It means distances between parasystoles have a common denominator, and this is the second criteria of ventricular parasystole. Sometimes impulse from the sinus node and impulse from the parasystolic focus occur simultaneously. In this case, some part of ventricles is activated by the sinus node, and some part is activated by parasystolic focus. On ECG, in this case, we see fusion complexes. That usually has transitional shape between the normal sinus complex and parasystolic ventricular complex. Also, fusion beats are characterized by presence of P wave that is recorded before the fusion beat, because the atria activation by sinus node is not affected. Usually, PR interval in case of fusion beats is shorter than in normal sinus activation. The presence of fusion beats is the third criteria of ventricular parasystole. As a result, we have three criteria of ventricular parasystole: varied coupling interval more than 100 milliseconds, the common denominator of interparasystolic intervals, and presence of fusion beats. If you like the content, press like, subscribe to our Telegram and YouTube channel, and have a good day!